shorefront, and he also did Pier Village, and those were, and he designed the landscape for this. And we came back a year and a half ago and asked if we could modify those approvals to add in a service station, because we'd been trying to market a pad bank for approximately 4 years with no success. This board granted that relief, and you imposed upon the applicant certain requirements. One was the landscaping plan had to be preserved. In fact, you asked that we enhance it, and then your staff asked that we enhance what you enhanced. So you have the preserved, enhanced landscaping plan on the plan this evening. And there was a number of drainage concerns in the immediate area. And the last 6 or 8 months were the fairly intense time working with your staff. The last 18 months is how long it took to get all the drainage under control. I'm very pleased to hear Mr. Dominic indicate that that issue is under control. We also agreed that when we came back before the board, we would talk about hours of operation. And when we brought the use variance, we postponed that discussion. Essentially, we needed to find out who our tenant base would be. We now have, we're very pleased that 7-Eleven has signed a lease for to be the anchor as both the service station and the convenience store anchor. We're going to ask the board to consider a 24-hour operation, which is necessary for us to keep 7-Eleven and for 7-Eleven to be competitive with the likes of Wawa and Quick Check, which, if you haven't already seen, I'm sure you'll be seeing fairly soon, because the three of those companies are now aggressively establishing their stakeouts throughout central New Jersey. With that as the brief opening remarks, I'd like to go right to introducing to you the witnesses who will testify. Seated alongside me to the left is Andrew French. He is the engineer who designed the plans. He testified at the time of the use variance. And blue tie next to the easel in the back is Steve Rodosti, and he prepared all of the architecture. As I indicate, Mr. Bruce Solovsky, who is your principal, is here, and he has with him his family, his support family, who is here to cheer him on. So I'd ask if we could swear in Mr. French, we'll briefly repeat his credentials and go right to his testimony.
Yes, sir. Do you solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
Yes, I do.
And your name for the record?
Andrew French from French and Perella Associates.
Is that functioning?
Hello?
Yeah. Okay.
It has to be real close. For yeah. Just
okay.
Like real close.
All right. Gotcha.
So, Mr. French, would you take just 2 minutes to share with all of us your professional and educational background?
Certainly. I have a Bachelor of Science degree in civil engineering from NJIT. I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of New Jersey. I provided testimony in front of this board as part of the use variance application for site engineering.
Okay, we can move on. Very fine. Start to remember that.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you very much. Mr. French, I'm going to ask that we go through this in a very succinct, systematic method. The first is I'm going to ask if you could introduce the first exhibit that you have up for the board, and then if you could use that exhibit to identify where this property is in the township of Franklin.
Certainly. This exhibit here is an aerial photo of the property as well as the surrounding uses. Should we mark this as A1?
Okay.
A1?
Sure.
So A1 is an aerial photograph with the property outlined in yellow. I'm going to ask if you could describe the current condition of the property. I know that this photo shows some buildings. If you could speak to the buildings that are on the property or not on the property.
Yeah, certainly. The site has frontage on Hamilton Street as well as Veronica Avenue. It's located at the corner. It's approximately 2.8 acres. On this image, which was from April of 2015, there was actually two residential structures located on the property. They've since been demolished and removed.
If you could just for just a moment describe the surrounding uses, the large white buildings. What zone are we in and what are we surrounded by?
We are in the M2 industrial zone, and the properties to surround from the rear of the site are commercial and industrial uses, as well as the southern portion of the site, again, is industrial and commercial uses.
And across the street?
On the other side of the street, on Veronica, is a funeral home. And again, commercial, again, to the rear. On the other side of Hamilton Street, there is existing residential.
Could you introduce your second exhibit? We'll mark it as A2. Could you read the title block and describe it to the board?
Yes, this is the landscape plan, sheet 7 of 16, last revised November 20th of 2015. This is the actual landscape plan that was submitted as part of the application, with the only change has been color rendered.
A2, Mr. Bradshaw?
Yes.
Yes, thank you. We'll go through the statutory elements of a site plan in a moment, but if you could just do an overall description of the applicant's proposed use of this property.
Certainly. Similar to the uses that were proposed as part of the use variance, we have a 2,958 square foot 7-Eleven convenience store, 11,115 square foot retail center, and there's a covered fuel and gas station.
If you could describe to us, describe to the board, the grading on this property. What did you need to do to this property to accomplish the plan that's before the board?
Certainly, under the existing condition, the grades are higher along Hamilton Street and then drain gradually toward the rear of the site towards Veronica Avenue. As part of the design of the proposed improvements, we situate the building at the highest level elevation and then grade and direct the runoff away from the building. As part of doing that, we have various inlets throughout the parking area that collects the runoff.
And the stormwater drainage system that you just began to describe, it's my understanding that that's what you have been working with the staff for the last 6 to 8 months to complete.
Yes, that is correct.
Would you describe it in general terms? And I don't see a stormwater system. Where are you keeping it?
Yes. The stormwater is actually an underground detention system. It'll be located in the front of the buildings and on below the parking area. The underground system is a combination of perforated pipes as well as solid pipes. The system itself, we collect the runoff in inlet structures. It's directed towards the underground detention system. And on both ends of the system itself, there's water quality devices that the runoff goes through to clean and treat the water. Then from there, it's directed into the underground detention system. The perforated pipes portion of the system allow it some of the water to infiltrate back into the ground. The rest of the system is designed to detain and hold back the runoff so that it can be slowly released in a controlled manner, and it ties into the storm sewer system on Veronica Avenue.
I heard Mr. Dominic in the opening remarks indicate the engineering issues are under control. That specific issue, have you and Mr. Julio Vega worked that out?
Yes, we have, yes.
Thank you.
I'd like to point out that this system meets the township requirements, and we submitted to Soil Erosion and Delaware Rounding Canal Commission, and they've also approved this system.
I think, Mr. Chair, members of the board, your applicant, as he approaches the board this evening, has in his possession, and we've also made them available to you, the county approval, soil conservation approval, the DEP LOI, the DEP general permit number 6, and the approval from the Delaware and Raritan Canal Commission. They're all in place. If you could describe the circulation design, and what I'm interested in is the ingress and egress points and the on-site circulation of all the anticipated vehicles to the site.
Certainly. On Veronica Avenue, the furthest from the intersection, we have our full movement driveway. This driveway is two-way driveway. It allows for in-out full movements. Towards the center of the property on Veronica Avenue, we have a right turn only driveway that provides access into the facility. On Hamilton Street, our driveway has been designed to allow left turn in, and right turn out only. As part of the circulation throughout the site, in the front of the building and is all two-way circulation. The only one-way circulation we have is behind the building itself. This is to accommodate loading and unloading that would occur behind the building and maintain the traffic flow in one direction. The circulation and the configuration of the driveways, as we indicated, Somerset County has approved the plan in the way it's laid out today.
Working with staff, the driveway that is off of Veronica that is in only, working with staff, I know that that driveway location was considered to be a good location, but there were specific requirements that were imposed on the applicant. And I believe that those were to make certain that the geometry and design made it difficult for someone to use it improperly. Could you describe what you did to that driveway so that it can only be used as an ingress driveway?
Yes, certainly. At the location of this driveway is key that we've aligned it so as you pull in the one-way only as you enter the site, it aligns directly with our flow of traffic on the inside of the circulation. It's also important that the width of this driveway and the configuration of the turning movements as you come in, the width of the driveway is 15 foot wide. The minimum requirement is 20 foot wide. But the reason why, working with staff, we actually reduced it so as to prevent people from trying to make that left turn in into the property on Veronica and that wrong movement. We want them to go to the intersection, to the furthest driveway from the intersection to make the left-hand turn. So this driveway has been configured to have it more narrow, 15 foot wide, to accommodate only the right turns in.
That 15 foot dimension, which you have included specifically by design, would require a variance from this board. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
And it was at our township staff's request for that dimension, correct?
Thank you.
Yes. We were working with staff to actually reduce it to 15 foot wide.
We anticipate that there'll be deliveries, there'll be fuel deliveries, there'll be trash removal, there's the potential of emergency vehicles, and there'll be our customers to the site. Have you laid down the necessary templates throughout the driveways to confirm that the driveway system, as designed, accommodates all of those vehicles?
Yes, we have.
And that's been submitted to the township?
Yes.
The landscaping plan that we began this discussion, I would ask if you could point out where the superior landscaping areas are, describe all of the landscaping elements, and then talk about the enhancements that were generated during the past year.
Certainly. The high standard of landscaping that was part of the original use variance approval has been maintained on this proposed plan. The key element is along Veronica Avenue as well as Hamilton Street, there are landscape berms. As part of those berms, there's a variety of different species of plants, from deciduous shade trees. We have ornamental trees along there. There's evergreen trees. There's actually perennials and ornamental grasses that align all along Veronica and Hamilton Street. And they're bermed up to also enhance the look of that landscaping along the frontage of this property. One of the enhancements that we're working with staff to incorporate into this design was also to provide a row of shrubs along the inside portion of our parking and site configuration. And that aligns all the way, again, along the inside portion of that berm. One of the other enhanced elements that we did add, as recommended by staff, is to, along Hamilton Street up to the intersection, we actually made a double row of shrubs along that area. So we certainly think that enhances this plan even further than was originally proposed.
Will that enhanced landscaping in any way protect the residents across the street? You're looking ultimately for 24-hour business. And I'm just wondering, is the berms designed to in any way protect the other side from additional lighting or noise?
It's certainly going to help screen and block some of that. The berm is about 2 feet high along here. It is elevated above the roadway elevation, and that's why the double row of shrubs on the inside, for it's supposed to help screen out the activity that's going on. So it certainly would be enhance that screening.
2 foot berm was designed to capture the sweep of the headlands.
Those babies and Avery.
The lighting plan, first, all LED lighting throughout the parking field?
Yes, everything is LED technology lighting, yes.
Second, the lighting, there was a comment from staff about reducing some of the poles that were 25 feet down to a lesser height. we able to accommodate that?
Yes, we certainly can. Part of the design on the lighting, as you arrive into Hamilton Street and along the front of the building, it's decorative gooseneck-type style lighting. Throughout the rest of the parking area, we have low-profile, standard parking lot lighting. What we had proposed along the front parking area was to have 25-foot-high poles to project the light out and illuminate the area. That certainly is necessary where we have the underground detention basin, where the lighting has to project far enough to cover that area, because we can't have light poles inside the basin. But the area over towards the intersection, staff made a recommendation if we can reduce that light height from 25 to 16 foot high, and we're certainly agree to accommodate that, and it will provide sufficient lighting in that area.
You're able to do the lighting plan without any hot spots or dark spots and have a uniform lighting plan, even
yes.
with those change in heights?
Right, yes, the lighting will be uniform, and the LED is certainly a great technology for this particular site.
If you could talk about the signage that is proposed. The architect's design of the signage will present when Steve is up, but if you just point out where the two signs are and how they've been incorporated into the landscape area.
Certainly. There's actually two signs, monument signs, one at each driveway entranceway, and those monument signs will have the gas brand logo as well as the gas prices. Then there is also one third sign that we have close to the intersection of Veronica and Hamilton Street. Now, this sign is to identify the 7-Eleven as well as the other retail store names. Each of the signs themselves are monument style, and the architect will describe them how they're compatible and aesthetically matching the architect of the building. As far as the landscaping, each of the signs themselves, we have a planting bed around them with ornamental grasses and shrubs to enhance the interest in the signs themselves.
Dumpster locations. At the time of use variance, we agreed that we... Dumpster locations. At the time of use variance, we agreed that we would specifically discuss the dumpster locations with the board.
Certainly. The dumpster, we have two. One is located behind the 7-Eleven store. It's a smaller dumpster, about 12 by 12 area is designated for that. Again, we have it screened around with landscaping, and then because of the one-way access, it could be easily provided with a dumpster truck that's front-end loaded. The other dumpster location is at the rear corner of our property. This is a little larger, a 12 by 18 space. Again, we've screened it with evergreen trees around the back, and it's easily accessible from front-end and able to pull back out behind the buildings.
At the time of the use variance hearing, this board asked that the applicant include a generator to make certain that fuel could be pumped in the event of the repeat of loss of electricity for an extended period of time. Where have you included a generator on this site?
The generator is located at the corner of the building between the retail and just behind the 7-Eleven. We're able to tuck it back in that little space there, put bollards around it to protect it. In the event that there's electrical outage, that generator will be able to use for the gas pumps and to continue to pump gas.
Mr. French, there are a number of staff reports, and most recently the staff commented on your last submission. And I know that, as Mr. Dominic indicated, that you've met with the staff on a number of occasions going through those reports. Are you comfortable advising the board that you can and will address the few outstanding technical requirements that are set forth in the staff's reports?
Yes, I do.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, I have no further direct examination of Mr. French. He's available now to the board and staff or at the conclusion of the hearing, as is your pleasure.
Okay, any board questions?
I have a couple. The retention basin, that's all underground, right?
Yes.
Is there any maintenance to that?
There will be ongoing maintenance. There's an operation and maintenance manual that we've prepared that provides guidance for what needs to be done to clean out the water quality devices as well as maintain and clean out the underground detention.
But it doesn't have to be dug up to do that?
No.
Okay.
There's a manhole that you go down in it.
All right. Yep. The one way up there, is that big enough for a semi to turn into if needs.
Yep, we ran the turning templates for a WB50 tractor trailer to circulate behind the building, and then actually can circulate all the way back around and go out Veronica Avenue.
But I'm talking about the one-way.
Yep, the one-way. It can circulate behind the building.
And I think you're, Mr. Rich is pointing to the one-way driveway in off of.
Oh, no. This would not accommodate tractor trailers. That would just be for regular passenger vehicles accessing the site.
So how does a semi-driver know that he's not supposed to turn in there?
We can sign it. I mean, there's considerable directional signage already required, but we can sign it.
Yeah, I think if he's coming from Hamilton, he's not going to try to make the left.
If he's coming from
the left of the drawing, he's going to encounter the main entrance first anyway.
Right. Correct.
Perhaps a no truck sign or something might further.
All trucks,
typically, the
no
truck
trucks.
Drivers, when they see a narrow 15-foot wide with a tough turn, they're not going to make that movement. Not to say that, you know.
You may recall.
Typically, the professional truck driver would not try to make that movement.
Won't it also be limited by the fact that the trucks that will be coming in there are coming there specifically for a delivery that should be able to get instructions if they need it or will have experience being there? And it is still my understanding that you're not in business for in the gasoline portion anyway. You don't want to attract tractor trailers. You're not there to service them.
We specifically agreed with this board that we would use the 1-inch nozzle, low volume pump that trucks just don't want to wait for. They want the 2.5 inch diameter, high pressure pump, and we specifically agreed there will be none, and that's memorialized in your relief.
Can't we just simply ask as part of the application that your tenants instruct their delivery people if they're coming in that size vehicle?
Absolutely.
What entrance to?
Goes right in there with the parking instructions that we give the tenants to. Absolutely.
At least it would limit it, the chances.
A very, very good point, yes.
Anything else?
Well, my question was, as you pointed out, Chairman Thomas, is are they servicing tractor trailers at this particular gas station? This is not going to be a Phillips 66 or truck stop or anything like that.
When we were here the last time, we had an extensive discussion with you and the board members. Pointed out, we don't want them, and the best way to control that is that low flow, small diameter pump.
How would they know that?
The signs tell them.
The sign would tell them.
Yeah.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. And nobody would make the mistake more than once.
Yeah.
We also—that's also an effect that the one that was approved last night on 27. No big trucks.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
I have a question.
No.
The lighting under the canopy looks a little high to me. You have 51.8 foot candles at one of the pumps. I guess, Vince, did staff look at the lighting under the canopy and glare?
Well, we did look at the lighting. It is relatively high. One of the things that's in my staff report with regard to the canopy lighting is to make sure that they were flush with the canopy, not protruding below the canopy to prevent the glare. I mean, the source of light is going to be concealed. The ground surface underneath the canopy is relatively bright, as they always are. But we did review it to make sure that there's not going to be off-site glare resulting from that light.
Okay. If you could just make sure with the engineer to look at that and make sure, because it seems really, really high. And do you need a design waiver to have more than 0.01 foot candles across the property line?
One of the things that we had talked with staff, it doesn't specific in the ordinance about the spillage, but we've agreed to provide house side shields on the lighting that's adjacent to the property line in the side and the rear to reduce the spillage.
Yeah, there's a little bit. When we met with Julio, we're going to come up and push that back a little bit with the shields to something that's acceptable to staff.
Okay. The lighting plan doesn't even take into account the lights within the signs. Or does it?
The lights within the monument signs?
Yes.
I have to go back and look. But usually they're not high, intense lights that are on the monument signs. They're just illuminating the signs themselves.
All right. So, but the signs are going to stay on, you propose, 24 hours a day or during the evening hours, all evening hours. And the canopy would be on all evening hours.
The hours of operation for the 7-Eleven are 24 hours. We are going to ask the board to allow us to have this 7-Eleven logo sign and the fuel pricing to be on 24/7. The canopy perimeter, you'll see, is all about architecture, not about lighting. And the lighting under the canopy, for safety reasons, needs to be on during all hours of operation. So the answer to that is yes.
Okay.
We have, because it's an LED lighting system, we have the ability to turn the intensity of the lighting down. So general parking lot lighting, now, no, we're not asking for any relief for the general population, the general stores. We had agreed that those businesses would close at 10, and we're not asking for any change on that hour. So the general parking lot lighting could be turned to a 50% intensity. You still have lighting, still have a illumination, but the intensity could be greatly reduced. The only place where we'd have to keep the intensity of the lamps at full would be in the fueling area.
Would it make sense to put that in the approval?
Sure.
Board.
Yeah. We think that would be a good idea.
Do we allow other gas stations to be open 24 hours?
Yeah.
I mean, there's an Exxon with the 11 store.
The only reason why we're talking about limiting it at all is because they were granted a use variance. We don't have any prohibition in this township on any business being open 24 hours. If you're in a zone that permits it, you're allowed to be open 24 hours a day. Just like if this was developed as a factory or any other type of use the M allows, they could be open 24 hours a day and we would have no control. The only reason we're talking about it is because this is an M zone that does not permit the gas station. The one we approved last night at the planning board is open 24 hours, the Wawa.
Would this be, I don't know if abusive is the right word, to the people who live across the street?
Well, I mean, that's a decision for you to make, but I don't know if there's any one of them here to testify tonight or to talk about that, but I think, and the applicant will point out, that it's in an M zone and there could be something that's operating 24 hours a day if they didn't build this. And I'm not advocating for that. I'm just pointing that out for the board. It could be a factory or they could have trucks driving in there in and out if they had some type of food processing plant like we have a block down the road.
Like our neighbors.
Yeah.
But they don't have lights on all night.
They have the right
open air lights. On Elizabeth Avenue, across from Somerset Run, we limited the lights to 10 o'clock at night.
Yes.
So I'm wondering if this falls under the same kind of problem.
That is for the board's deliberation, and that's what the applicant's asking for.
Only because people live across the street.
Well, it's not because people live across the street. It's because it's in a zone that doesn't permit it. One of the reasons why you may give it more or less consideration is because what it's boundaried by. I mean, that's for you to decide what's more important or what helps the neighbors or doesn't help the neighbors.
Has the township staff taken this into consideration?
And we worked on a whole slew of issues, but when it comes to issues like this is really a board decision. It's, as Vince said, if this was a permitted use, if this was in a neighborhood business zone, you wouldn't be talking about it, because they're allowed to be there, they're allowed to operate. Just like if this was a, if they were before you for a warehouse or a light manufacturing facility on this site, which is zoned M2, you could have a large warehouse with an open parking lot and trucks going in and out all day long. You absolutely could, as of right. The only reason we're discussing and have the ability to discuss this 24 hours operation or dimming of the lights, or if it's the 7-Eleven and or the gas station, is because it's a use variance and you have some leeway to impose those conditions because of the surrounding neighborhood.
Well, council's already made that offer.
And so that's why this is not, you know, we've discussed 100 different things with this applicant to narrow it down. This is one of those things where the board has to be the referee, and the board has to make that decision.
And we did, and one of the reasons why they offered to dim the, you know, the lights in the parking lot is because we told them the board would be concerned about that, so they're able to do that. Now, that's up to you to decide whether that's appropriate or not appropriate. That's not for staff. We try to get them to the point so there's only a couple issues, and we knew this would be one because it was punted to now.
What hours would the lights be dimmed, and how much?
If I might.
If you open 24 hours a day, how would you dim the lights?
I'm going to ask for permission to do something. I have one witness more, that's the architect, and then these questions that you're asking me, I would like to take a 5-minute recess so I could speak to Mr. Brusilovsky in detail, and then we'll come back and we'll finish the discussion on hours of operation and hopefully work something out with you. But if it's acceptable to the chair and the board members, I'd like to go to the architectural witness, complete that, and then ask for just a 5-minute recess.
You understand my concern?
Loud and clear. Loud and clear. And that's why I need to speak to Mr. Brusilovsky, so I know he's listening too.
If there aren't any more board questions concerning other issues, I'd like to open it to the public. If there's anyone here who would like to ask questions concerning this witness's testimony, come on up.
Bill Connell, 25 Spring Street. Do I need to go under oath?
No, if you're not, you're just asking questions now, you're not making a statement.
Okay, just a couple things. I live off of Spring Street here, okay? I'm a Democratic committee person. I'm on the open space committee, and I just want to make a point. I am not picking a fight with the owners. I've watched too many meetings where things get out of control. I'm going to make a few statements, which I believe to be
fact. Well, if you're going to make a statement, you want to wait to the end. You'll have that opportunity. This is okay. Just for questions.
I just want to explain who I am and what I'm doing here. Okay, so, sir, as far as I know, there is only two properties here. There's a rental property and it's almost a business running out of here. It's a residential. Okay, so really there's not a lot going on here. Okay, when you talk about lighting, I think I didn't expect to talk about this, but when we talk about lighting, and
I'm going to swear you in, sir, because you're okay. Not.
Okay.
Okay. You solemnly swear, affirm, tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth.
So help me God. Okay.
Generally, this is when you ask this witness questions.
I'm getting to that.
Hold on a second. Okay. You keep saying that, but then you're not listening to us.
Okay.
Then at the end of the meeting, you can make public comment.
Okay.
That's what you seem to be doing right now.
Well, I wanted to address his concern before you.
You're not here to address his concerns. You're here to ask this fellow questions right now, and you will get that opportunity probably in about 45 minutes.
Okay. So I got that.
You're going to ignore me?
I got that. No. Okay. Now I'm going to ask my specific question, or what I came here for. As a resident of this neighborhood, okay, I can honestly say when I heard the traffic persons, whoever you hired originally when you got the approval, they completely understated the dangers and potential problems of the situation. Okay, I'm not a traffic engineer, but
this is once again a statement. I mean, it really be helpful if you asked the question instead of all the preface.
Okay, my question is, when the county approved this, okay, as a member of this neighborhood, okay, when you take a left-hand turn out of here, okay, when they originally put the traffic light in, I was concerned. Okay, it actually made things better because when you took a left-hand turn out of here, okay, it was like the Wild West. by virtue of this being put in here, it mitigates any positive effect of the traffic light. So when you leave this neighborhood and take a left-hand turn.
We're still waiting for a question. Please ask a question. The board wants to get this done.
You want a simple? Did the county actually take into consideration people in this neighborhood when they gave them the approval for this? Did they really understand what the potential problem is here? And
I can answer that question. I attended those meetings.
Ken, you just use the mic, it'll pick up. Thanks.
I attended those meetings with the county over a period of about 4 years.
Yeah.
We worked with the county in their redesign, and we worked with the county in the redesign of the roadway. We participated in the road widening and the improvements, and the exact location of the driveways and the design of the driveways is as the county engineer dictated. We worked with them on the details of construction. I didn't ask them.
I can also tell you that the township met with the county and the applicant on the issue, and the whole access issue and making sure it worked with the lights. The county is extremely anal about making sure that the roadways, and in fact, sometimes we have to push them. They review the entire area. So the answer to your question is, they reviewed that entire area to make sure that light would still function at the level that it's functioning at.
Okay. Can I see that in writing?
They have county approval. Once the county approval, that means they've looked at the entire. If you're questioning how the county approved it, then you're really going to have to speak to them, not to this board. The board's concerned.
So you're approving something that you don't understand how they arrived at the decision?
The county has jurisdiction over Hamilton Street. As Mr. Pape just explained, they've been working with the county for 4 years on and off. The design of the entrance on Hamilton Street and the redesign of the Hamilton Street and Veronica intersection, they've been involved with all along. As far as something in writing, this doesn't tell you their inner thoughts in their minds, but we do have a memo from the county, September 3rd, 2015. The plans have been revised as requested and are now in general conformance with county standards. So to answer the question, why did they approve it? The answer is in writing, because they are in conformance with county standards. That's the answer in writing from the county. Why they comply? Well, there's probably a book this thick that explains what the standards are. They don't tell us every last detail.
The same standards they used for South Middlebush and Denherder and Amwell Road?
But that's not before us.
I understand that. I'm just saying, I'm making a point. All I'm asking is what criteria
approved by the county. We've heard the question. We've answered the question. There really isn't anything else that we can say. If you're concerned about why or how it was approved, go speak to the county. We have the approval letter. There's nothing more that you can ask on this subject that you're going to get more information. And I'm sorry to be like that, but
I understand.
The board wants to get to the rest of the application.
There's also nothing we can do to change it. That recommendation.
But I just want
from them. It's their jurisdiction.
But you still need to understand the recommendation. You're saying the Somerset County said this is okay, but do they understand what they okayed? Okay, that's all.
Thank you.
Okay, I beat it.
Okay, next. Again, we got away from standard operation here. This is really a period of time to ask the witness questions about his testimony.
I promise my questions will be easier.
And you will get to make a statement.
He's much easier.
Vincent Vignolo, 1347 Hamilton Street. I'm right at the base of that. So just a couple quick questions. I'm on a well. My well water is wonderful. I love my well water. Many of the people in my neighborhood are on wells. What promise do we have that this water condition will not be changed as a result of the business? What assurance can you give us?
Use the mic, sorry.
Our stormwater management design has been in conformance with the state standards for stormwater management, where the runoff gets treated through a water quality device to the state standards, then it goes into the system to infiltrate back into the ground. So we're following the state rules.
Did they take into consideration that a lot of the residents in that neighborhood are on wells? I understand, but you're putting impervious cover in, you're putting a gas station. There's going to be possible
The answer is that the stormwater regulations require them to make the site conditions better after the improvements. So in essence, the water flow, the amount and how fast it flows off is better. I mean, that's in layman's language, that's what they're
requiring. If our water condition does go bad, what assurance do we have that we can have it fixed?
I don't know. The assurance is that what they're doing will have no effect on your well.
Okay.
I mean, that's what the stormwater regulations require them to have it. If by some crazy thing it malfunctioned, then you'd take any normal step that you would take with anything else that malfunctioned.
And a wooded area there which purifies water as it flows and goes into the aquifer.
Once again, the existing condition and how everything moves off site and the rate is made better. And that's by the state and the local requirements.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was the hard question. These are the easier questions. Living there, and please understand, I'm pro-business. I own a small business in town. I've been in business for 25 years. So I'm very pro-business. Will the delivery times and delivery days be limited? It's not your people, your customers coming in and out are not going to cause a lot of noise. But delivery trucks, garbage trucks, things like that will cause noise in the area. Will you have a restriction on the time that they can deliver and the days that they can deliver?
The answer is that the board can have that discussion with the applicant
Just put it out there, please?
Yeah.
No, because we do like to sleep a little bit. The other question I have is, what percent of evergreens are in that berm?
Percent?
Yes. A berm is only so good if it can block. I know from experience, because when they redid Hamilton Street, I raised the bed on my front yard and put more evergreens in to block the sound and the noise. So what percent of evergreens are in that compared to trees that are going to lose their leaves and shrubs?
Right. The shrubs themselves, we were talking with staff to make the shrubs that are along there, 75% of them, evergreen shrubs versus deciduous. The trees along Hamilton Street, I'd say it's more... 20% of the trees are evergreen versus 80% are deciduous trees.
Can you increase the evergreens to block more? I only say that from experience because when I increase the evergreens in my yard, I have better blockage because the street, when the cars come down the street, they come right at my house.
The landscaping plan is a combination of two things. It's one of creating beauty and creating buffering. We're very comfortable that we have answered each and every request that was made. If we go to a solid wall of evergreen trees, we block the view of the center, and we're not comfortable blocking the view of the center. We're comfortable screening it. We're comfortable having the lamps of the vehicles completely blocked, which is why the evergreens up to 3 or 4 feet are 75%. But we'd be very uncomfortable going beyond that which we have presented to you with large evergreen trees.
But you don't live there. And what height trees are you bringing in initially?
The evergreen trees, it's 6 to 8 feet in height. They're planted at.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we'll close the public for a moment. And you, any other questions? Now, at this point, you want to take a...
I would like to present the architect to you, and then, Mr. Chair, take
it. Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Steve Radosti is the architect for this project. Was the architect when we were here the last time, too. We'll begin with Mr. Radosti being sworn.
If you'll raise your right hand for me, solemnly swear or affirm to tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay, thanks.
Mr. Radosti, would you take a few moments to share with us your education and professional background?
Yes. I have a Bachelor of Architecture degree from New Jersey Institute of Technology, and I'm licensed as a professional architect in the state of New Jersey since 1996. I have my own practice with a partner since 2003, and I've designed hundreds of projects throughout the state of New Jersey.
All right, we can go on.
Thank you. Mr. Adasti, I'm going to ask if you could identify the three boards that you brought with you this evening. I think we could have them marked A3, A4, and A5. If you could go through that process, and then I'll ask that we begin by presenting the building to the board.
Yes, of course. I have here board SK1. And I'm sorry, you said this is A3.
That appears to be four sides of the building that have been rendered. Is that accurate?
Yes, that's correct. And then I also have sheet SK3, which are the canopy elevations. And that's A4. And then I also have sheet SK4, which are the monument sign renderings.
Versions of all three, and with permission, Mr. Chair, I'd like to deliver copies to each board member.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Sure.
Couldn't hear what you're...
Yes, it's
he's going to distribute those.
Oh, three. Okay.
Thanks. Mr. Adasti, if you could begin by presenting the building design to the board members.
Yes. Okay, so the proposed retail building is approximately 231 feet 2 inches in length, and it is 65 feet in depth. And on the left-hand portion, on the north side, there would be a mini mart, which is a 7-Eleven, and the remainder of the building would be for a future tenant space. The building would have in the tenant space would have a large amount of glass along the front facade with decorative grills. This would be either a silver or white colored aluminum frame. There would also be, the building has this rhythm of brick piers between the bays. And there would be, above that, we have a canopy with a stucco facade with a white an off-white border for that. We also have a hardy board siding, which is a cementous siding, which is horizontal siding that we have throughout the front facade. We also have dimensional fiberglass roof shingles, and we varied the roof in height and shape to add some visual interest to the front of the facade to create this rhythm of the bays as they go along the building. We also added architectural interest. We're having decorative peaks and gables with windows, alternating triangular shapes and rectangular shapes, create some more visual interest. Now, we followed this same palette of materials and the same design around the other three facades of the building. The north elevation here, we follow the brick wainscoting, the hardy board siding, the stucco with the decorative trim panels. Also, we have an A-frame on either side of the building, on the south elevation also. And then the rear of the building, we follow the materials around the rear. We have the brick piers. We have the stucco. We have the A-frames. The building itself has a flat roof in a good portion of the roof, but it's also screened by a pitch roof, which would screen all the mechanical equipment. The rear portion of the mini mart would also have a flat portion of roof that is also screened by decorative stucco panels to match the decorative stucco panels on the remainder of the building.
I have a board that I believe you put together. This shows the actual materials and the colors that were selected for the building. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Mr. Chair, with permission, may I pass it to the board members for their examination? Okay.
Thanks, Ken.
the signage that has been designed, I note that you have a combination of signage, a mixture of gooseneck lamp signage and channel letters with backlighting. If you could describe the signage scheme and then talk about how your professional opinion as to how that scheme will work.
Yes, for the retail spaces, we have individual letter backlit channel signage for the various spaces here. But for the 7-Eleven, which would act as an anchor store, we have a non-internally illuminated 7-Eleven sign that's lit by LED gooseneck lighting. We would also have LED lighting, decorative lighting, that would wall washers that would wash up and down the columns to add some visual interest to the building. Also, that none of that light would go out. It's basically just a wall washer.
And the 7-Eleven sign is distinct, and that is the sign that has the lighting coming back at the building. It's not lighting that's projecting out into the parking.
That is correct. There are LED goosenecks that would just shine on the building and the sign itself.
You also were asked to design a canopy that was consistent with the architectural treatments of the building. And I point out to you that this is a canopy, unlike any canopy I've had the privilege of presenting to a board. It has the full architecture and all of the materials of the building incorporated into the actual canopy. Could you describe those elements,
Mr. Oh, yes, of course. The canopy itself is 105 feet in length by 36 feet in width, and it's supported by brick columns to match the columns on the existing building. The canopy itself, the facades of the canopy or the fascia of the canopy, would be the same stucco-type panels that we have on the building. That would be that kind of cream color with the light, the off-white color trim, and that follows all four elevations of the facade of the canopy. We also would have a hip-type roof. There'd be a flat roof, but there would be a hip roof that would that matches with dimensional roof shingles to match the existing building, and that's also on all four sides of the elevation. There would be a canopy sign on the north elevation and a canopy sign on the west elevation, and it would be 9 square feet, 3 feet by 3 feet.
You describe the characteristics of that sign?
Yes, that sign is a single face internally illuminated sign, and it's 36 inches by 36 inches.
There are two of those on the canopy?
That is correct.
And where the two are because the property is at a corner of two roadways?
Yes, that's right.
I know that your ordinance says the canopy can have one sign. We're asking that we have two because we're at a corner and we'd like to identify our brand to the traffic on both roadways. I'm going to ask if you could also identify the monument signs that you designed. I think if you could start with the larger of the signs and advise the board as to where it's proposed to be built and talk about its purposes.
Okay, I'm going to start with the site plan then. So the larger monument sign is located on the corner here, and that's to identify the retail buildings. And then the smaller monument signs, they're located here and here, and those are the gas price signs. And if we could go on to the larger sign. So we wanted the signs to look like they were part of the building, that we have all the same materials. Once again, we have the same brick columns. We have the same cornice and stucco material. In this case, we have a small arch at the top, and we have gooseneck lighting. We have some brackets, and we have a base that would match the wainscoting on the main building. The signage itself, the 7-Eleven sign, and the retail signs would all be lit by the gooseneck lighting, and the gooseneck lighting would match the type on the building. It would be the same style, and it would be LED lighting that would focus just on the sign and not throw the light outward.
The smaller monuments are single purpose. The smaller monuments are just identifying the fuel brand and the fuel pricing. And that's by design. Your ordinance has a recent amendment and allows the use of the LED digital lighting on signs that they are for single purpose. You can't introduce any other purpose for the sign. So did you accomplish that? There's no other purpose of those smaller monument signs.
There is not. The small sign has the prices and the name of the gas station. And once again, we went with the same materials that were on the building, the brick columns, the base, the arch with the address. The price signs, there's a cash regular sign. Oh, these would be LED digital signage, and they would have red lettering for cash regular and cash credit. And then for diesel, the lettering would be a green LED.
Is this 7-Eleven brand gasoline? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. 7-Eleven, Wawa, Quick Check, they're all at war with each other. They're convenience and gas at the same time. If you could go back to the building plan for just 1 second, there is a second variance that we would like to ask of the board. Again, because we're at the corner, there's a second sign for the 7-Eleven. There's a 7-Eleven sign over the main door, and there's a 7-Eleven sign on the side facing Hamilton. That second sign is necessitated because of the corner property. And again, it does require a variance. So we're asking, the variance relief that we're asking is to have an extra sign on the canopy because we're at the corner, and an extra sign on the building because we're at the corner. Mr. Chairman, looking at my notes, I have no further questions for Mr. Radosti. He is available to all of you for examination. And
okay, Ward, any questions?
Yes. In looking at this, it looks like if this was broken down, you could get, what, 7 different businesses?
Yeah, there's 7 bays, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 bays plus the 7-Eleven.
And what would be the minimum?
Minimum size or?
No, if that's the maximum, you could have 7. What would you consider the minimum amount of?
Could be 1.
Just 1?
It could be. It's not. It's not expected. No.
Other questions?
The signs, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
The signs you were talking about right there, are they lighted?
The signs. These are non-internally illuminated. They're lighted with the LED gooseneck lighting.
Oh, like, okay.
7-Eleven is going to use a gooseneck back on its building.
All right, if there are no questions, again, we'll open to the public. If there are questions that you have for this witness, now's the time to ask. Anybody? Go ahead. Just identify yourself.
We need the mic.
So what is the total height of both of those signs? They're not the normal flying signs like the Delta gas station has, like probably a 20-foot sign. So none of the signs other than the one on the building is any higher than...
So the large sign is 12'4" in height, and the smaller signs are 8 feet in height.
Anybody else? Okay, we'll close that part. Next.
Now I'd love a 5-minute recess to speak to Mr. Brusilovsky.
Okay, we can stay at 5.
Yeah, and I would ask that you, when you talk to your client, talk to them about the deliveries that Vince brought up, because that's a typical condition that the board would put in there. So if there's a way to clarify that when you come back, you know what he wants. He doesn't want them done early in the morning or late at night. So with that in mind, that would be very helpful.
Okay, we'll adjourn for 5 minutes. Does that mean you have someplace to go?
No. The fog's so bad, and because we were up so late, I'm just going to Frank's. No soccer. No soccer tonight.
Remember last meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, where were we?
Well, that's because I had my uniform underneath my jacket and everything else ready to go.
Do you wish to address those concerns through another witness, or?
I have authority to make a proffer on behalf of Mr. Bruce Solofsky, who's the principal of your applicant.
Phone to the mic, Ken, please.
With regard to deliveries and trash removal, we would offer that deliveries would not be before 7 a.m. Trash removal would not be before 7 a.m. Deliveries would not be after 10 p.m., and trash removal would not be after 10 p.m. We have total control over it's all private haul and private delivery. We can make that imposition. With a station, a fuel station, can't tell you what days of the week, because when the tank needs to be refueled is when you call for the fuel. So days of week, not comfortable putting restrictions. Hours, very comfortable to those that were offered. With regard to the hours of operation, I'd like to offer this. 7-Eleven requires their convenience store to have hours of operation 24 hours, 7 days a week. They do not require their fuel station to have the same hours. The fuel station can be open from 5 a.m. to 11 p.m. 24 hours for the convenience, fuel 5 a.m. to 11 p.m. And what we could do is, when the fuel the general shopping center is closed, which is at 10, we can turn all of the general parking lot lights to 50% intensity. LED, you can actually pick the intensity. So we offer to go to 50%. Still safe, but much, much less light. Two, when the gas station closes at 11, all of the gas station signage goes off and the canopy lights would go to 25%. We're not comfortable having a dark area under the canopy, but at 25% surrounded by the 50% lighting on the side and 100% lighting immediately in front of the 7-Eleven, we feel would be very safe. And the only signage that would remain on would be the gooseneck lighting on the 7-Eleven signs. Now, there's gooseneck lighting on the sign on the main monument, and there's gooseneck lighting on the 7-Eleven sign on the building.
Would remain 24/7.
They would be on whenever illumination is required. If that worked for this board, it would work for 7-Eleven, and it would work for Mr. Bruce Solofsky. We'd ask you to consider it favorably.
Okay, now. We'll keep that in mind for in the next few minutes. Do you have any other witnesses?
I do not, Mr. Chair. The applicant's presentation is complete. We have addressed, we went through your staff's requests. The engineer has testified to the engineering elements and the architect to the architectural comments. I believe that the testimony requested by your professionals is fully before the board.
Okay, then we'll go directly to the public. If open to the public for you to make a statement. Whoever wants to go first, we're all looking at.
So, I guess my point.
I'd remind that you've already been sworn in.
And just repeat your name so when they do the minutes, we'll know who you are. We know who you are, but they.
Bill Connell, 25 Spring Street. Okay, I'm here as a neighbor, okay, and I've been there for 22 years, and the traffic patterns I pay attention to, and my only concern with this is I think it's a great addition to the neighborhood. I think it's pretty decent, the lighting situation. That's really for the people directly impacted to make that call, but I think it's a fair concession. Again, taking a left-hand turn out of Spring Street, okay, you take your life in your hands, okay? I watch it all day long, and I was in I was left with a memory of your traffic consultant when this approval was originally made, how she understated, okay, the potential problems, okay? So, and then when I saw where the exit is, okay, which is right, almost, you know, right in line with Spring Street, when you take a left, you have to look a lot of different places, okay? And you really have to do this, okay? If you do it to really understand. And I'm just concerned where the placement of that exit driveway, the fact that it's there at all, okay, causes me great concern as a husband, a father, and a neighbor. So to say the county approved it, okay, that's great. Okay, the county are a bunch of geniuses, and I think we can look around the county and find all sorts of great ideas. So I want to know what criteria they used, and did they take Lake Avenue into consideration, okay, when they gave the approval, what criteria they use, and what part did Lake Avenue play in the decision to give an approval to say, yes, this was a good idea?
You know, what we have before us tonight on this board has to do with two variance requests that has absolutely nothing to do with traffic management. We don't have the authority to even consider that. When they said to you that you should go to the county to see what was considered, that's the answer. We could have all the opinions in the world, and it would mean nothing. Right now, before us, two issues and two issues only, and that's what we have to address.
Yes. I don't know. Well, I don't think we swear.
No, you need the mic because it won't pick up on the record.
And I have to swear you in. Okay, so if you raise your right hand for me, solemnly swear, affirm, tell the whole truth, nothing but the truth. And your name again for the record.
Vincent Vignolo, 1347 Hamilton Street. First, I'd like to say, as a small businessman and resident, I really respect all the extras you went through to make it very friendly, very neighborhood friendly. It's a great plan, and I really hope it goes through and does really well. I think it's a disadvantage that you can't run the gas station 24 hours, because there are 24-hour gas stations in the area, and it would be helpful. And I'd just like to see a few more trees. Thank you.
Hey, thank you. Okay, then we will close to the public. Is there anything you want to add to your presentation?
If you want the gas station to be open 24 hours a day, just ask.
Well, I mean, the board could allow you to keep it. I mean, that's up to the board. We'd
have no objection. We're comfortable 5 to 11, but 24/7, as this gentleman just asked, we can do that too.
All right, then, board. It's discussion and come up with motions.
I have a question on 24-hour operation. Is this gas station going to accept cash as well as credit cards?
Yes.
Yes.
Because, like Costco is smart. They always take credit cards, so they don't have to worry about cash. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm talking about, we read in the paper all the time about gas stations and those kind of stores being robbed in the middle of the night. So I don't know if you're concerned about that.
It hasn't been an issue.
Okay. Well, if you read the papers, you can find it every week.
And I'm sure you're going to have surveillance there, surveillance cameras all over, right? And
the applicant, I think, operates quite a few of these, doesn't he? If I remember correctly from the discussions that we had.
Lots of these.
Yeah.
All over the state.
Any other comments, questions again, or motion?
I have a comment.
Go ahead.
Sorry. I think the applicant's proposal is very reasonable. I think there's a ton of large-scale landscaping, particularly along Hamilton Street. But I would ask staff to just look at the under-canopy lighting levels one more time to make sure that it's not overly excessively bright and doesn't produce excessive glare.
We can surely do that.
Thank you.
Okay.
I think it's a really good application. I have driven there frequently, and the site is a mess, and it'll be really nice to see that. I think that the signs as requested are appropriate, and the driveway width appears to be appropriate, so I would move to approve that application. And I think that the particular conditions that you set forth, and I suppose I could enumerate them, but you probably have them, right?
Are you allowing them to be open 24 hours a day? No. I hope you do, only because so I can get gas, like after last night's planning board meeting that Bob kept us here to almost midnight.
I like the idea of starting at 11. They can always come back.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. I think that the limited...
That matters not to me. I just want to know so that...
No, I think that the limited gas station hours, at least to the moment, if it becomes really difficult, come back, we could be open to that.
This applicant would have the option to come back another time for relief if this were operating and...
They always have the option to come back and ask. We would require notice. I would require notice for that. I mean, a lot of times for something minor and a relief of conditions, we wouldn't. But that would be something I would require notice so that the neighbors would know to come back and be able to have input on that.
I don't usually do it, but it isn't like we're overloaded with people.
No.
No.
No, the other way.
The other way.
No.
Okay. No. Way around. Absolutely.
All right. You have a motion on the floor incorporating items that have been discussed. Is there a second?
A second.
Any further discussion?
Okay. Ms. Grauman.
Yes.
Mr. Johnson.
Yes.
Mr. McCracken.
Yes.
Mr. Rich.
Yes.
Mr. Caldwell.
Yes.
Mr. Rosenthal.
Yes.
Chairman Thomas.
Yes, and I think the applicant has shown a tremendous amount of cooperation to get over the last couple of years. And I think it is a difficult property the way it looks now, and this should be a good improvement. And good luck.
Right.
Is there anyone who would like to move to close?
Someone.
Nobody wants to.
Second.
All in favor?